order. Can I welcome everybody to this additional special meeting of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. It's good to see everybody here. Thanks for your attendance. Before moving into the detail of the meeting, there are a number of housekeeping points as usual that I just want to mention. Can I please remind everybody that all mobile phones should be turned to silent for the duration of the meeting, and to ensure that everyone in the chamber can hear the debate, can I please ask that members and those presenting reports use the microphones and please speak into them so that everybody can hear, and they work best when the microphones are close to you. And finally, as ever, the meeting will be filmed by officers from the Combined Authority and will be available on the Moseley Council YouTube channel later today. So, those are just the housekeeping points I wanted to mention. So let's get into the agenda. Item one are apologies. Angela, have we had any apologies?
Yes, Chair. I have apologies from Robert Cluff, and Asif Hamid is here as his substitute. We've also had apologies from Cllr Ian, and we've had apologies from Cllr Mann. Cllr McKenna is expected in place of Cllr Mann.
Very good. Thank you very much. Welcome to Asif. Okay. Item two, declarations of interest. Have any declarations of interest been received, Angela? Okay. Right, so let's go straight on then to the main business, which is item three, the potential devolution of powers and funding to the Liverpool City Region. As I'm sure everybody knows, the reason for this special meeting of the Combined Authority is to consider this item around the potential devolution of powers to the City Region. There's a covering report in the main agenda pack, with a further report in the supplementary pack, and there are final replacement recommendations which have just been given out on the yellow paper. So I hope everybody has got sight of those revised replacement recommendations, which we will consider shortly. Can I just check if everybody got those recommendations? Yes? Yeah, that's all right. Okay, that's great. So, to kick things off, I'm going to ask Jed Fitzgerald to do a brief introduction to this report, and then we'll have a discussion. Jed, thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, everyone. Just to recap on the Chair's comments in terms of the paperwork and to highlight one particular point, this the draft document which was published on Friday has been strengthened in one or two areas. There's some typographic errors and some small drafting clarifications and so on. That process is still kind of working its way through, and obviously will be continued subject to the comments that you made as referenced by the presentation. But in particular, I should highlight that we've now built in a sector cloud governance, which is kind of being circulated to the members concerned. And that's to strengthen the reference to the approach we've taken around governance, which is basically around what I described to you last week in terms of the prize versus the price kind of issues and the balance. Take on the conclusion of the outcome of the negotiations that we're about to enter into if we move forward from this point into the submission and into detailed negotiations with government. Just to recap, Chair, kind of go back to where we were. The framework for devolution, cities in the devolution bill, progressing through Parliament at the moment. There'll be a number of amendments to that, I imagine, before it's finalised. Around about Christmas time, we're expecting. And to be clear, that the government's own preferred governance model for the devolution to be optimised will be around a potential city region elected mayor. The budget statements that the Chancellor made on the 8th of July confirmed that we are engaged in negotiations, or prepared to engage in negotiations in detail with government around a devolution deal. And that the mechanism for that is the document and the discussion that we're about to have around that to be submitted in accordance with the government's requirements by the end of this week. And then the conversations and negotiations will go through during the autumn. And the comprehensive spending review will be published in late November, early December. There's no specific dates that I'm aware of on that just a minute. And it is clear that the bottom of that book comment on that slide, Chair. Devolution early adopters will, we are told, benefit in the comprehensive spend review considerations. Exactly how and to what extent clearly is what we will find out about all things being equal over the next few months. The opportunity for devolution of the maximum variety rather than the minimalist variety is clearly what we're looking to engage in. It builds on the strength of the city region growth deal and one of the highest levels of awards of funding that we're given out in the entire country. That's partly due to the strength of the pipeline of projects, but it's also due to the strength of policy making and the working collaboratively that we're now doing and forming the combined authority and all those things that we've been working on and improving around how we work over the past couple of years or so. So the kind of platform for this is actually pretty significant from our own point of view. The slide references the Northern Powerhouse. Obviously, for the Northern Powerhouse to be meaningful, it doesn't need to build on exactly the kind of range of combined authorities that now exist across the north. The work that's ongoing around Northern Powerhouse, rail and transport for the north and so on, and some of that overlaps to the specific text that we're including in our submission proposal. But also, it's worth highlighting 2 points, Chair. First is both the reference actually in the foreword. Comprehensive spending review takes place amongst ongoing austerity measures, which we all know, but it is worth just reflecting and remembering that the six local authorities in the city region have already suffered over £650 million worth of cuts since 2010. And that actually is the equivalent of the value of the first European Objective 1 programme for the area, which many of us remember made a massive contribution and a positive to the kind of way of governance, of economic development, of community engagement, participation, and strengthening communities, and providing more job opportunities for local people and so on. So on the one hand, we had the benefit of that over many years, and on the other hand, over a short period of time, we had the equivalent of that money actually taken out of the local authority budgets in the past 5 years. And the second is an interesting reference from a report done by the Institute of Public Policy and Research, which is a think tank, which identified that for transport projects alone, spend per head in London was £2,731 per head, but in the Northwest, £134 per head population. And that shows the disparity across the country of some of the big items of spend that we're looking to gain some influence over in terms of what the devolution process is actually ultimately about. Points to emphasise on this slide, Chair, is around the core principles around accelerated growth and improved productivity. That's the essential ingredient of what we're trying to secure through devolution. The second, but clearly alongside it, is public sector reform and making existing money go further. And thirdly, to improve outcomes and health and well-being and so on, the deal that local residents get in the Liverpool City region. And the core of our argument is that under a devolution arrangement, the deal will be better for local residents and local businesses, and that we will be able to make better use of the funding that is already in the system, regardless of further ongoing austerity or further cuts that would happen arising from the comprehensive spending review. Second bullet point, Chair, is that our contention would be that locally developed and delivered solutions work better than a one-size-fits-all national approach, and we've talked about that in part at the last meeting of the Combined Authority. I think people in the room would understand the principle behind that. Thirdly, that this is, just to emphasise, this is about drawing down powers, control and resources from national government and government departments to the local city region. It's not about taking power from the existing six local authorities in the local city region area. And the bottom bullet point, Chair, I think is pivotal. It's having the power to make local decisions over significant areas of national government spend, rather than priorities for local services and funding being decided all too often in London. And that, in essence, is a significant part of why we're having the conversation this morning. Just to recap on the themes, Chair, we referenced these last week, and I've got some more text to read out on this in a second, but that's the kind of the outline scope of the documentation that's before you and the submission that we're first set of assets around driving economic growth, business support, skills and employment, financial message or new funding. I'll just talk over this slide, Chair, if that's all right. A place-based multi-year financial settlement for local government and for the public agencies in the city region. Why do we want that? Because if there are going to be cuts, we need to have the flexibility over a managed period of time to be able to cope with those kind of cuts. That's the experience that we've all had as individual local authorities, and my contention will be that that's no different given the scale of cuts that's likely to impact on other public agencies and other public bodies in the city region. Through this mechanism, the ability to manage that matter is clearly going to be easier and better if it's locally based and decided rather than in London, Whitehall, Westminster, as I said a second ago. Secondly, we'd be looking for development corporation status for the Liverpool City region and some particular geographical parts of the city region. Development corporation status currently only exists in London around the Olympic Village and in Liverpool around the original city of Liverpool City Council. So we think that's significant to ask and bring some financial benefits arising from that. We'll be looking for a single place-based investment programme and pot of funding to combine public and private finance and assets for economic development purposes. That builds on the track record that we've generated around the growth deals and other sources of funding that we've put in place over recent years. We are looking for greater certainty, clarity and flexibility for integrated transport funding, specifically the special rail grants, highways maintenance and other individual pots of funding. Again, we think we could make better use of if they're collectivised and determined and decided locally rather than elsewhere. The government should recognise the locational business case and skills advantages of the city region as a solution, a viable solution to the government's own current relocation of government departments and public agencies review, and that's something that will run alongside the comprehensive spending review, and I think we're well placed geographically with the track record of the government departments and the presence of government departments already in the city region. We're looking for legislative clarity on the ability to utilise tunnel toll income for wider economic development purposes. That's currently restricted by the legislation as it stands at the moment, but we are looking to be able to amend the legislation to allow the tolls that are received through the tolls to be actually invested in wider and broader infrastructure and economic development and transport infrastructure across the city region. We're looking for a demand-led approach to business support rather than provider-led through co-commissioning and the alignment of national business support funding streams to the city region. That's particularly important and significant, Chair, because we are anticipating that the funding reductions to BIS, the government department is responsible for business support, will actually mean we think the business support will pretty much disappear across the country. And in areas like ours, it's very important to ensure that business support is retained and that we can customise that and focus on the economic development that businesses can bring to the city region in terms of jobs, investment and training opportunities. We're looking to align skills and employment provision with local employer demand. That's been an ongoing journey that we've been on through a range of growth deal propositions. And we're looking for significant devolution around the powers and resources in that space. But obviously, we need to be very mindful of potential liabilities in that space as well in terms of ongoing contract obligations for our work program, for instance, and one or two other good programs as they are. Looking for the retention of 100% business rates of income in predefined development zones and sites that would probably overlap to the corporation status that I referred to a little bit earlier. Looking for the ability to access what's referred to as project rate of borrowing to bring forward development. Basically, that means cheaper forms of borrowing, which will allow our own money to go still further and for projects to happen a lot quicker than it would otherwise. Looking for the creation of a land commission to basically give us much more say and influence over government assets, property assets, and building assets in and around the city region, and also to ensure that we're insulated in case the communities agency disappears through a comprehensive spending review to make sure that the kind of activities it's been undertaking in the city region, we retain the benefits of rather than going down to the disappearing entirely. Specifically looking for the designation of two what are referred to as catapult centres. one floor manufacturing technology focused on marine and renewable energy, and a second on infectious diseases. In both cases, we've got sources of competitive advantage in the city region. We need to make sure that we can optimise those for the benefit of UK PLC, but obviously for economic development purposes in within the city region. We're looking for maintained investments in the International Festival for Business, which we've already secured for 2016, as you know. We're looking for that for 2018 and 2020, looking to develop that as a product that the city region can benefit from, rather than being moved to Tempe, Manchester, dare I say, or anywhere else outside of them. And lastly on this slide, Chair, we're looking for designated, what's referred to as intermediate body status for European funding for the £200 million worth of allocation for European cash, which is a reduced sum, as you know, in terms of what we've been used to over previous years. And just to emphasise the fact that the government has decided that that should be currently run by a national programme serviced and supported out of London, and all the decisions made in London, rather than that which, again, we've grown used to in Liverpool and other areas where it's been determined locally. And the intermediate body status request would give us much more flexibility, much more say and influence over that locally, as opposed to that one size fits all that, again, I was making earlier on. Next set, Chair, around transport, free trade zone, housing special planning, and cultural partnership. Looking for greater influence over the tolling regime, I referred to that a second ago on the previous slide. Looking for reduced financial risks associated with planned replacements of the Mersey Rail electric rolling stock, which is a key requirement for Mersey Travel and for the quality of the existing set of arrangements on Mersey Rail. Rolling stock is now in an advanced stage of its program life, I think it's fair to say, and still works very well, of course, but obviously the sooner we can make that decision and implement that, the better the quality of the experience for Mersey Rail customers. Looking to secure the ability to franchise local bus services. I don't think any comments on that, Chair. I think everybody's dissatisfied with the ongoing deregulation of buses from 1986 through to the current day. Looking for the development of a Liverpool City Region statutory spatial plan that will give us both the flexibility and planning terms to be able to determine much more locally that which influences planning and planning activities, rather than arrangement where several sets of issues currently reside with government, and we want more flexibility around that point. Single investment approach in housing, again, to give us much more flexibility over housing numbers and where new housing is going to be provided. That would overlap to new homes bonus, making sure that we actually gain some benefit out of new homes bonus, which we failed to be able to achieve as an area over the previous 5 years because most of it went to the south. Looking for the devolution of the necessary tools to deliver improved development outcomes through housing markets and also better social benefits at local level through the housing arrangements. Looking for powers to maximise renewable energy and the economic potential of the city region's assets in terms of the river and offshore tidal power and the total arrangements around that, which I think are going to be increasingly important to the economic development of the city region into the future. A commitment to deliver through which is around energy and climate change, a successful contract for difference and electricity supply arrangements with special purpose vehicle for a direct connection to the output of the tidal lagoon if we proceed with that, and a share of any energy production profits to be retained locally arising from that particular set of investments and activities. Looking for the establishment of a regulatory pilot area around utilities to strengthen the frustrations and the real experience as local authorities in terms of utilities just turning out and placing codes on the roads of the perhaps in those roadmaps in terms of what we had to do with local issues. And we're looking to pilot that nationally, which I think would make a big difference in terms of how utilities approach hiring improvements and should hopefully improve the driver experience and reduce some of the congestion. Looking to develop a financially sustainable delivery model for cultural and creative assets. This is partly derived from the anticipation. fairly extensively over the last decade or more, which in themselves have contributed massively to the economic growth of the city region, and therefore would be placed at risk if the funding was taken out without us having more influence over that, and without perhaps setting up what we're looking for in terms of a down fund to help us to minimise the impact of those kind of changes around that. That in turn links across to National Museums and Galleries Liverpool, which is a national public amount, which are very worried themselves that the austerity measures to be announced would actually really jeopardise their future viability and sustainable performance into the future. We're looking for a deal around some national cultural infrastructure within the city region, which would further stimulate economic growth to cultural industries and activities within the city region to strengthen the performance and development of that area of the economy. And we're looking to develop financially sustainable solutions to nationally funded amenities and arrangements and services for the likes of national museums. So that's just detail on that slide, Chair. Final one, health, wellbeing, social education, children's services, community safety, enforcement, and license and regulatory services. Again, skipping through these. To work actively with local authorities, the clinical commissioning groups, Public Health England, and other national health agencies, to accelerate the definition agreement and implementation of local solutions which would improve the health and wellbeing outcomes for local communities. Looking for national partner support to inform the journey locally and to work with government to help us to secure mutually beneficial outcomes in this kind of space, but with the bottom line here about reduced liabilities to ourselves for this arrangement, but with better outcomes for local people and local communities, which is something that has consistently failed to happen in the city region over recent decades, despite the system. Looking for exploring detailed opportunities and risks associated with devolution of powers and resources for example, special health services, joining commission around, for example, military and prison health, emergency and non-emergency transport, including ambulances and primary health care, where it's currently commissioned. We're looking to consider and explore whether an elected Liverpool City Region Mayor, if that arrangement happens in due course, should take over the role of the direct elected Police and Crime Commissioner and the Fire and Rescue Service program, which is what's currently happening in Manchester. So we're watching with interest what's happening in Manchester, and we're looking to explore that and see whether that makes sense locally or not. Looking for flexibility to establish appropriate governance and operational arrangements in respect of waste across the city region, which is much about us organising ourselves differently, but also quality specific powers to be passed out from national government to ourselves to work matter. And we're looking to the power to establish consistent local licensing objectives across the city region to support health, wellbeing, and objectives and some greater efficiencies around that space. We're looking for the power to set consistent local fire levels for environmental crime across the city region, respecting better lighting and dog farming. That's going to chair that coming to the end of the presentation. The next steps are, as outlined, really, all things being equal, subject to your agreement and making an agreement this morning. We will be making a submission by the 4th of September. It will then receive formal ministerial consideration. Will effectively open the door to detailed negotiations around those items that I've quickly outlined this morning. The dialogue and negotiations will then be live from September through to probably the end of November, maybe the middle of November, at which point what I referred to last week as the decision point around weighing up what the price on offer might actually be versus the price that might need to be agreed. That process will only kick in around that time scale. It says middle of November, but the middle of November could be end of November. I'm not obviously certain about that at the moment. And to emphasise again that it will be a formal decision by each of the constituent local authorities on the prize, on what's on offer in terms of the deal, in that time scale. And it's only at that point that any individual authority, therefore the combination of authorities, will be asked to formally commit to. Until that point, everything's up for discussion and debate. some things I think won't be agreed, all things being equal, some will require further development. I think some will fall by the wayside as we go through the negotiation process. And just to emphasise again that if all of this follows through, the formal implementation of any new governance arrangements will only take place in April and May 2017, with the election of any new city region for the city region. So, what's that mention?
Okay, thanks very much, Jed, for that quite kind of comprehensive run through of the documents and the state of play on devolution. I now want to open up to members to make any points, ask any questions. So over to you. Who wants to go first? Joe.
Chair, just to make a couple of points. The first one really is about the scrutiny of this process. It was reported in the local press that there was no opportunity for scrutiny by political parties. I just wish to point out that this is the second opportunity that people have had to be here to ask questions or to scrutinise from the political parties and have it taken on. I just think that's a point that needs to be made because we're not being today clearly something that is interested in this commission that they are taking. That said, I just also want to make another couple of points, and it's important to stress at this time that this is, for me, an iterative response in terms of workforce. There will be meetings taking place over the next few months. This is an outline ask from us, from government, and government indeed themselves will have some asks of us. And it is a question of negotiating a deal that will come back and be presented to all the authorities, for all the authorities to agree on. I think it's also important to recognise and make the case and make the point to people within the city region that this isn't going to be a panacea for all the problems that we face. It is absolutely right that we inform them, as we have done, that the £500 million cuts that the city region has faced since 2010, with a plan of £420 million for the future. It's important that we recognise that. But it gives us the opportunity to actually shape how we manage and do things ourselves. And that is the opportunity that exists for us. With asking for things, that gives us the ability to develop skills, education, training, the environment, and all of the things that makes able us to actually cope with the cuts in the future. And I just think that's important to make that point, and that there will be opportunity for more scrutiny, more negotiation, more talks with businesses, with other political parties, with other interested groups like health, the voluntary sector, the trade unions and others to engage and involve themselves in the process over the next few months.
Okay, thanks, Joe. Rob?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I think the most quite right to point out the cuts that have been made, and I think that what we're having today is a procedural matter. The devil will be in the detail, and the government's just going to give us these powers and say, there you go, good luck. I think we need to consider that because it's got to bring with it some resources to deal with this. Otherwise, they're just going to put the onus on us if it goes wrong. So it is the beginning of a journey, and we look forward to seeing what turns out. So.
Okay, thanks, Rob. Other contributions? No. Asif.
Thank you, Chair. I do actually, in my capacity as Vice Chair, endorse a recommendation, I think, to one particular document in the answer there. And it will go back to the LEP board. One of the things I do just want to pick up on is the engagement from the private sector. One of the recommendations I would like to make is that the LEP becomes the voice, or has the mandate to serve as the voice of the private sector, to help to engage with the private sector to feed back through the process ongoing over the oncoming period. So I think it's essential, as James Walton said recently as well, is that the private sector is engaged, and anybody, any LEP that has engaged with the private sector ensures this will be favoured in submission. So I would ask for endorsement from members of the combined authority that the LEP becomes the voice of the private sector.
Okay. I mean, on that point, I think, you know, Joe and I were at a meeting of businesses last week, and I was, and you and I, Chair, of the Chamber of Commerce in Wirral, we were at a meeting yesterday of businesses, and I think there's a reference in one recommendations to over the period between now and when the deal is concluded, to put appropriate consultation in place, and I think the voice of business is a critical part of that, in my view. And I think the LEP is clearly a key player. You know, the LEP are a member of the combined authority, and they are the voice of the private sector. There are other business forums as well that I believe you need to listen to. And can I just say, I think the other key players in all of this consultation is the public. You know, over the next 10 weeks, we need to find a mechanism to gauge the views of the residents on the potential deal. But we're not at that stage yet, because we don't know the detail, as Joe said. This is really kind of the 4th of September I'm seeing as the kind of starting gun, really, for the detailed negotiations. And once we're into that, we can bring more information back. But absolutely, we need to hear the voice of business. We need to hear the voice of the LEP and the other key kind of stakeholders, if you like, in our local economy.
Okay,
Steve.
Just to keep you informed, I think the LEP has had six of the local associations recommending that the LEP, and I'm more than happy to share the names of the organisations that are required to do so. Six of the major organisations within the city region have actually supported or endorsed the LEP to be the voice of the private sector. I think while I fully appreciate the engagement with the private sector, I think it has to be channeled through one voice, I think. Otherwise, we're going to end up with lots of different voices coming from and nobody channel and bring them all together. I think it's key strategically that we have one area where it all comes together and feeds into the combined authority.
Yeah,
Joe.
Yeah, just to point out, and is part of the process. You know, we will be criticised by other organisations that represent businesses to say they won't be involved, and they're not. And the LEP is, but equally, you know, from our point of view, it's not just the business components of this deal. There are many other asks within the deal. What businesses have to play, as the LEP does within the role of the CA, and also within the role of the devolution as an important role. What we have to engage with every sector of businesses, the small and medium enterprises, the big businesses, you know, so the private sector in all its guises has to be involved and engaged. Equally, you know, we get criticisms from others within the health sector, within the higher education sector, the universities, but all the people that, because we're talking about public sector change, we're talking about the ability, the opportunity to change things differently. And they all want to be involved and engaged, and that's exactly what we've got to do. We've got to engage and discuss with people how we make a difference in the future and in the very near future too.
Okay, so I mean, I think, Asif, we absolutely get the key importance of the LEP as a private sector. And I think, over, Jed, if I could just kind of ask your advice on this, you know, in the pretty near future, presumably, we'll be drawing up a kind of consultation kind of programme, if you like, as the negotiations roll out.
Yeah, I think we recognised a meeting last week, but also there's the comments that we made already this morning around this. The starting gun analogy that we just used a second ago means that we've got to consult much more widely and much more fully over the next few months as this process unfolds in terms of the scale and scope of the negotiations that we have up to this particular point, because this has been a very rushed process, I think, for all concerned. And concertina over the summer period, which is never the easiest to try to kind of move these things through. But as we get from this point forwards, there will be a structured framework for consultation engagements on a range of different settings. And locally, there will be business engagements, and the way people are in touch in terms of several meetings already happened, more of those to kind of take place. There will be more structured engagement information for other public agency partners, and we
Okay, any other points that colleagues wish to make? Okay, if not, can I ask you to look at the replacement recommendations on the yellow paper, generously provided by Merchant Travel this morning, thank you, David. So the yellow sheets, everybody can see those recommendations. So I'm going to ask, are these replacement recommendations points 1 to 5 on the yellow sheet, are they agreed? Okay, thank you very much. So they're agreed. Thanks very much, Jed, for your presentation. So I've not been informed of any of the urgent items. Okay, so just to say in closing, to thank everybody for their attendance, thank members of the public for coming along and showing interest, and just to remind you that the next ordinary meeting of the Combined Authority will be at 10 o'clock, Monday the 21st of September. Please note this is a change date and time, so can you please make a note of that in your diaries, and I declare the meeting closed. Thank you for your attendance. Thank you.